Good morning, everyone. Myself, Dr. Dilpreet Singh, working as an associate professor in the ISF College of Pharmacy, Moga. I welcome you all in the e-dialogue series hosted by the ISF College of Pharmacy. But today, my topic for my presentation is the FDA-approved formulations utilizing the novel drug delivery systems. First of all, we have to understand what is actually a drug. A drug is an agent that intended for the use in the diagnosis, mitigation, treatment, cure, or the prevention of disease in the humans or in the animals, and which are, this definition is also officially included in the Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act 1938. So, what is drug delivery? Drug, the appropriate administration of drugs through various routes in the body for the purpose of improving health. It also refers to the various approaches for delivering a pharmaceutical compound in the human body to achieve or optimize the desired therapeutic effect while minimizing the adverse effect. So for a successful drug delivery, some factors were taken into considerations like the physicochemical properties of the drug, body effects and the interaction, route of administration, patient comfort and the well-being. So the conventional therapy, the conventional route of drug delivery, it provides the non-targetability in the tissues and organs due to its peak value fluctuations like non-targetability in the various body organs. So the frequent administration of dose, it can also be a troublesome for allopathic medicine, leading to the poor patient compliance. Novel drug delivery systems not only reduces the frequency of administration, but it also reduces the peak value fluctuations, which leads to the enhanced bioavailability and the solubility of the drug. In addition to the traditional approaches like the oral injectable type of the formulation and other types like the inhalational implant suppositories or ophthalmic type of the dosage forms, NDDS provides the targeted delivery and the drug device combination and are now attracting more and more attention in the drug development. NDDS provides drug release at a controlled rate and maintains the overall therapeutic concentration of the drug in the body. The three major goals of NDDS, they are providing sustained release drug release, selective targeting to the site of action, and it increases the patient compliance, which leads to enhanced therapeutic activity of the drug. So what is actually a need of the novel drug delivery? The needs of the novel drug delivery is to provide the maximum therapeutic effect, to minimize the adverse effect, to increase bioavailability, to minimize the drug degradation, to improve the compliance, and it reduces the overall health cost. So in this presentation, we have summarized some of the novel drug delivery system along with FDA-approved formulations, like the controlled release drug release loaded microparticles, targeted ligand molecules, transdermal patches, gastrotentive drug delivery systems, nasal type of the formulations, ophthalmic formulations, gastrotentive formulations, and the antibody drug conjugates. First type of the FDA-approved novel formulation is the microparticle-based sustained-release type of the formulations. Microparticle-based sustained-release formulation, they have been developed to facilitate the controlled release of therapeutics. Microparticle-based depots includes a polymeric material which basically is biodegradable in nature that allows for the protection of drug cargo and control over the drug release. A number of polymers, they have exist depending upon the which type of drug is to be formulated. Some of the examples include the polylactic and co-glycolic acid, like the PLG type of the formulation, which mainly used in the drug delivery profile. Polylactic acid, polyglycolic acid, they are perhaps the most commonly studied polymers in the recent times. This type of the polymer have the versatility in the tuning biodegradation time and high biocompatibility arises from their natural byproducts, lactic acid and the glycolic acid. By sustaining drug release over longer periods of time, these systems aims to improve the delivery of peptides or proteins by reducing its injection frequency and also reduces the dosage regimen and extend the drug release over a longer period of time, which reduces therapeutic effects and it improves the overall therapeutic profile. So the type of the FDA-approved formulation that developed through the microparticle-based sustained-release depot is the first formulation is the Lupron depot. Lupron depot, it consists of the leuprolide hormone. Leuprolide is basically a hormone that has been used for the treatment of advanced prostate cancer and other hormonal problems. It consists of leuprolide encapsulated in the PLG microspheres. Leuprolide is a synthetic analog of the gonadotropin hormone, which was originally approved in 1985 as an injectable. However, constant and repetitive injections spurred the interest in a more patient-compliant formulation. So Lupron depot is the one of the first example of the new class of the controlled-release polymeric drug delivery systems and was originally developed by the Abbott company in 1977 in the or is had been approved by the FDA in 1989 for the treatment of the advanced prostate cancer. Lupron-Depo is available as a subcutaneous or intramuscular injection that has been approved for the management of endometriosis and also for the treatment of central puberty and other hormonal disorders. Lupron-Depo has been commercially successful with the annual billion sales of around $1 billion annually. So Lupron-Depo, I mean, that main advantage is that it significantly lowered the number of injections required for the treatment. Lupron-Lite required daily injections. However, the Depot formulations, like the sustained release micro-particle type of the formulation, it requires the injection every 1 to 6 months. So it's drastically reducing the dose and the frequency, thereby dramatically reducing the number of the injection and increasing the both patient compliance and the convenience. Lupron-Depo is a perfect example of a polymeric controlled release drug delivery system that improves the patient compliance by offering long-acting and long-lasting alternatives to highly invasive daily injection therapies. Next type of the formulation available for the novel drug delivery system includes the Nootropin-Depo. Nootropin-Depo is a somatotropin gamma DNA origin that developed by the Genentech company, the first long-acting formulation for the recombinant growth hormone. Nootropin-Depo is a biodegradable microparticle depot formulation that was approved by the FDA in 2005 for the pediatric growth hormone deficiency. In clinical trials, Nootropin-Depo it shows the increase in the growth rate in the children and adults with the pediatric growth hormone deficiency, while requiring 1 or 2 doses a month compared to the standard care, which require multiple injections per week. So it drastically reduces the number of injections and the frequency. Nootropin-Depo delivered a much larger molecules because the somatotropin hormone is having the molecular weight of around 22,000 Dalton. So then the previously FDA-approved microparticle depot system, Nootropin-Depo, however, is commercially available due to its low cost and the high manufacturing challenges. Nanoparticle for cancer-based therapies. Nanoparticle represents the most studied drug delivery system. Over the last 10 years, more than 25,000 publications have been focused on the targeted drug delivery using nanoparticles. Within the field of nanoparticle drug delivery systems, cancer remains the most studied target. Nanoparticles provide the clear advantage of delivering chemotherapeutic drugs as they provide the drug protect from degradation in vivo. It providing the targetability to diseased tissue. It provides the controlled release rate at the target site. Doxil, the first cancer nanomedicine that has been approved as a nanoparticle formulation. Doxil, currently marketed by the Johnson & Johnson, is the first FDA-approved liposomal nanoparticle formulation for the treatment of certain cancers and experienced the commercial success. Doxil is a liposomal formulation of doxorubicin and was approved by the FDA for the treatment of AIDS-related Kasson-Nie sarcoma in 1995 and for recurrent ovarian cancer in 1988. The development of Doxil was enabled by the research that shed light on the various aspects of liposomal formulation, including long circulation time, sufficient enhanced permeation and the enhanced retention effect, stable drug loading into liposomal and releasing the encapsulated doxorubicin to target tissues while it doesn't harm the non-target tissues. It exhibits the enhanced circulation, increased tumor resistance, and it improved the half-life as compared to free doxorubicin. As a result, Doxil benefits from the less off-target side effects. It enhanced the tumor killing properties. Other type of the nanoparticle-based cancer therapies, they are still in the clinical trials. They are yet to be approved, like the Markibo liposomal formulation. Markibo liposomal formulation contains the vincristine as the API molecule, which was approved by the FDA in 2012 for the treatment of rare leukemia. Abraxane is also a FDA-approved formulation that is basically an albumin-based liposomal formulation. It is basically used as a chemotherapy drug. It performed well in the initial clinical trials and that has been approved for the treatment of various other cancers. It having the excellent commercial success with the preliminary annual sales in 2003 for around $649 million. Next type of delivery system was studied is the transdermal drug delivery system. For the purpose of transdermal drug delivery system, we can examine the structure and the function of human skin that were categorized into 4 major layers. You already know that the skin containing the 4 major layers, like the innermost subcutaneous fat layer that called the hypodermis, the overlying dermis layer and the viable epidermis layer, and the fourth one is the outer layer of the tissue that is called non-viable epidermis layer, that is called stratum corneum. The FDA approved formulation type that are available in the market and prepared through the novel drug delivery system is the transdermal patches. Transdermal patches is a novel invention that offer a painless patient compliance interface to facilitate the systemic administration of drugs. Many approved transdermal patches, they have a similar basic composition like a protective backing layer that prevents the drug leakage, a reservoir which stores the drug which is ideally small and lipophilic, and an adhesive layer that facilitates skin contact. Many commercial successful transdermal patches, they have been developed for a variety of applications, ranges from the birth control to smoking cessation. The first FDA approved patch that was available was a 3-day patch that delivered scopolamine for motion sickness treatment in 1979. So there are some desirable features for transdermal patches, like the composition that really invariant in use. Systemic system size reasonable, it defined the site of application. Application technique is highly reproducible in nature. Delivery is totally zero order because the infusion rate is constantly being extended for a longer period of time. Delivery is highly efficient in nature. First type of the formulation that is approved as the novel drug delivery system is the fentanyl patch. Fentanyl is basically a potent opioid analgesic that first synthesized in the 1960s and was quickly approved due to its rapid onset, short duration, which made it an attractive choice for analgesic versus different surgery treatments. A transdermal fentanyl patch that eventually known as Duragesic that was developed by Elza Corporation and Janssen Pharmaceuticals and was approved by the FDA in 1990 for chronic pain. Duragesic offered two main advantages over its counterpart, like the controlled release up to 72 hours period of time and having the formulation for self-administration. So it having that two major advantages for improving the patient compliance. The longer acting dose optimized fentanyl patch, it reduces the need for multiple injections, which greatly improve the patient compliance, reduces the overall injection times, frequency, and reduces the overall adverse effects as compared to the standard treatment of the opioid analgesic. So there are some marketed transdermal type of the formulation that is available for the different fentanyl patches, like the Ketapress that available is containing the clonidine as the active molecule that is used for the treatment of hypertension. Combi patch is available, which containing the estradiol or norethindione, which is used for the hormone replacement therapy. Habitrol is containing the nicotine as an active molecule used to reduce the smoking cessation. Transdermal scope is available that containing the scopolamine as an active ingredient that is used for the motion sickness. Nitrotrul is available, which containing the nitroglycerin as an active molecule used for the treatment of the angina pectoris. So what are the future perspectives of transdermal drug delivery? So newer and more sophisticated transdermal patches and other transdermal drug delivery systems, they are being developed, that are currently being tested in the clinical trials. Microneedles, they are being more advanced form of transdermal patches. They are investigated as a physical means of minimal piercing the skin so as to avoid pain, and jointly delivering a drug through a ported skin first systemic delivery. Commercial development of microneedles is also noteworthy. Genesso has been developed a titanium microneedle based technology applied via a reusable applicator to deliver parathyroid hormone, PTH hormone, across the skin for the treatment of osteoporosis. Parathyroid delivery is desirable due to its potent bone building effect, but is currently only being available as a daily subcutaneous injection. Genesso Pharma PTH offers a much improved non-invasive delivery method and a longer shelf life as compared to subcutaneous injection. So the PTH delivery across the microneedle technology is currently still in the phase 2 trials and was effective in the increasing the bone spine mineral density in the dose dependent manner, and it reduces the overall number of the injection and it extends the release up to longer period of time. So the third type of the delivery system was studied is the oral drug delivery. Oral drug delivery is by far the most commonly used mode of drug administration. This is evidenced by the number of oral formulations that have reached up to 100 type of the sold drugs in 2013 and about the 50% of the drug molecules in the hit list that been delivered to oral route. Predetermined doses that simplifies the patient compliance by administering self-administration of drugs orally as well as systemically. All incorporate drugs in the tablets like the one molecule or two molecule. They are the main advantage for the oral drug delivery. There are a variety of capsules available in the market, and in fact, novel capsule designs that offer an opportunity to develop novel oral drug delivery systems. currently, no peptides or proteins, however, they are currently delivered by the oral route due to its rapid degradation in the stomach and size-limited transportation across the epithelium. Yet, much effort has been spent on developing oral drug delivery systems for proteins, especially insulin. So the first type of the formulation that is approved for the through oral drug delivery is the OROS, osmotically driven devices. Osmotically driven drug delivery system that has been topic of interest. The early design of osmotic pumps eventually lead to the development of the osmotic controlled release systems like the OROS technology. The controlled release system by the OROS that are developed by the Elza Corporation, they was tuned by through a semi-permeable membrane which surrounds the drug molecule and allow for water penetration into the drug reservoir. Water permeates into the drug reservoir via osmotic pumping and it facilitates the drug release through an open pore. The rate of drug release is dependent upon the osmotic properties of the drug molecule and the design parameters that can be tuned into the controlled release profile of the drug through the OROS technology. What are the advantages and the limitations of the OROS? The main advantages of OROS is that it allows the controlled release of therapeutics. Several similar pills, they are suffer from the known controlled drug release profile, like the peak valley fluctuations, which lead to sharp peaks and valley in the pharmacokinetic profiles. OROS that allowed the improved properties in terms of the maintaining drug concentration in the plasma within a safe and therapeutic range. This allowed the less frequent dosing and fever side effects. Further, OROS provides an avenue for the delivery of poorly soluble drugs as evident by the success of Procardia XL. Procardia XL is a type of the OROS formulation containing nifedipine as a calcium channel blocker used for the treatment of hypertension. It is an extended release type of the formulation. What are the future prospects of the oral drug delivery? Oramed has been developed a technology to deliver peptides and the proteins by the oral administration. This technology makes use of a protease inhibitors to prevent the degradation of the protein in the stomach and absorption enhancer to facilitate the passage through the intestinal epithelium and the enteric coated capsule to ensure the release of the capsule content in the small intestine. This multi-mechanism approach has been developed by the Oramed company to facilitate drug release into a target tissue. Because insulin is the polypeptide hormone and when used for the treatment of type 1 diabetes patient. So repetitive injection, it takes a harm to the patient. So Oramed developed a once a daily oral pill containing a multi-mechanistic approach to treatment to treat the normal glycemia and were able to reduce the glycemic content throughout the day. Four type is the gastroretentive drug delivery system that is also called GRDDS. An optimum gastroretentive system that can be defined as a system which retains in the stomach for a sufficient time interval against the physiological barrier, it releasing the active moiety in a controlled manner and finally metabolized in the body. GRDDS can be used as an effective tool in the delivery of drugs that are primarily absorbed in the duodenum and upper jejunum or those that have the absorption window in the GIT. This system is appropriate for the drugs which are locally active in the gastric mucosa, for example, for antibiotic administration, for Helicobacter pylori eradication, and in the treatment of the peptic ulcer or other type of the gastroretentive formulations for the treatment of gastritis and other gastrological disorders. Drugs which are the less soluble or in the degraded by the alkaline pH may be benefited by incorporating in the GRDDS. So the choice of drug is very important for formulated into the gastroretentive system. Basically, drugs that are poorly soluble or it will be degraded by the alkaline pH are the drug of the choice for the treatment of, for the incorporation into GRDDS for the prolonged gastric retention and consequent improving the overall oral bioavailability and therapeutic efficacy by possible reduction of the dose size. So the type of the gastroretentive drug delivery system they are available like the floating and the mucoadhesion technology based system. Floating and the mucoadhesion technology based system, they are capable to float on the gastric fluid and then can bind to the gastric mucosal surfaces. FTC Limited, that is the basically a multinational company of pharmaceutics, that launches a novel dual working system of sodium ferritate based on the principle of flotation and the bioadhesion, that basically known as ferritate controlled release tablets. Developed system, it ensures the gastric retention in two ways. This product is based upon the bilayer tablet technology, whereas one layer consists of adhesive polymers and another one is the floating layer. The uniqueness of this product is the film coating of mucoadhesive layer which helps to get over the drawback related with the mucoadhesive systems. So the film coating of this bilayer tablet, it prevents the undesirable mucoadhesion of the tablets to buccal and the esophageal mucosa. So the high concentration of this iron from immediate release formulation can lead to GI toxicity. But the developed system like that controlled type of the formulation, it releases the drug in a sustained release manner in the gastric region that ultimately reduces the chances of toxicity and improving the therapeutic activity. Another type of the gastroretentive system is the swelling and flotation based technology. These systems work on the principle of swelling and floating system. Sun Pharma developed a novel gastroretentive delivery system which works on the same principle. This system has the core of drug and the rate controlling excipients that followed by a coating of the effervescent excipients. The coating of the swelling excipient is made over the effervescent layer and finally an immediate release coating is layered. Based upon this technology, Sun Pharma is selling a once a day product of baclofen to treat muscle spasm caused by certain conditions such as multiple sclerosis or to treat spinal cord injury or the other chronic diseases that will be treated by the swelling and floating based systems. Fifth type of the drug delivery study is the pulmonary drug delivery. Pulmonary drug delivery is mediated through the inhalation of the drugs through a variety of means ranging from the nebulizer to inhalers. Pulmonary drug delivery has been explored for the systemic as well as the localized delivery of the drug through the lungs. The advantages for the systemic delivery are that inhalation offers a rapid systemic onset in some cases on the order of minutes, which results from the large surface area of the lungs. In case of the localized delivery to the lungs, which has been the primary application for the inhaled medication, onset is very rapid. This is essential to treat several asthma attacks. Of the numerous inhalation drug delivery system on the market, the metered dose inhaler MDI that has been led to the most impact and most trending drug delivery for the pulmonary treatment, at making the asthma medication very simple for the patient to treat for the self-administered to themselves. The metered dose inhaler that has been also inspired to other inhalation drug delivery system to push beyond what we have originally think was possible, such as the inhaled delivery of protein or peptides. So the advancement of the MDI for delivering drugs to proteins and peptide, it makes the system very trending and very successful in the market for the treatment of various pulmonary disease conditions. First is the development of the asthma inhaler, that is the development of the first MDI inhaler used for the treatment of asthma. While other pulmonary delivery system like nebulizer that has been developed and has been used up to this point, and it found success due to its localized lung delivery, but they have limited as they were fragile in nature. And most importantly, it not able to precisely control the amount of therapeutic agent that given to the patient. So the MDI it revolutionized the pulmonary drug delivery system by offering a controlled release system to deliver a known amount of therapeutic with each dose. MDI is made up of propellants, drugs, and the additives like solvent, emulsifier, etc., and offering an excellent ability to control the therapeutic dose via a valve system. So the MDI design, it consists of a cancitor which contains the drug formulation, the metering valve which dispensing the predetermined dose, and the mouthpiece which facilitates the transfer of drug formulation into the patient. So the constant release of the drug release via a sustained release type of the formulation is available, and it hits the markets as compared to the nebulizer, which are the conventional route of drug delivery. So the two top selling combination inhalers, they are available like the Adavir that contains the fluticasone and salmeterol, and the Sembicort that containing the budesonide and the formoterol. It generated the billion sales of around $3 billion and $8 billion respectively in 2014. MDI offered numerous advantages for the delivery of asthma medications over nebulizers. The inability of the older nebulizer to control the amount of therapeutic dose, which resulted in increased potentially fatal side effects or overdose or insufficient delivery. So these inconsistencies, it allowed the MDI inhalers to provide the much needed ease of administration in terms of both consistent dosing and simple application procedures. What are the future perspectives of the pulmonary delivery? So the many other devices, they have been approved or are in the development or still in the clinical trials for the treatment of the other diseases, including the cystic fibrosis or the pulmonary arterial hypertension. So for the cystic fibrosis, Keystone and the Tobipe inhaler, they are available for the treatment of cystic fibrosis still in the clinical phase trial 2. Okay, Vendavis or Tyvaso is still available in the pulmonary arterial hypertension. It is the MDI-based formulation that allows the precise release of drug release. Inhalation, it offers a broad platform that can be systemically delivered peptides and proteins in a patient-compliant or non-invasive manner. In particular, they offer rapid absorption, lesser interference from protease as compared to other route, and highly permeability to the epithelium. So Exubra is aerosolized insulin. That's a breakthrough research. The first FDA-approved inhalable insulin formulation data available by the Nectar, called Nectar Exubra, which was manufactured and marketed by the Pfizer. The Exubra formulation, it stored and delivered insulin via a dry powder inhaler so as to maintain the peptide stability. Further, Exubra provides the appropriate aerosolized characteristics to ensure the pulmonary delivery in a low-dose powder filling so as to deliver a small doses and a physical device to control the dispersion and the reliable dosing to the patient. In a much clinical trials, Exubra provides the long-term insulin serum concentration in the plasma as compared to the subcutaneous type of the formulation. So despite the successful clinical trials, the additional cost of the Exubra caused the discontinuation of the product. So Afrezza is a modification of Exubra. Mankind is continuing to develop an inhaled insulin product that is called Afrezza, which potentially offers a compact inhalation devices, low dosing and a rapid absorption. Afrezza has submitted a new drug application and has been recently been announced a positive effect in the phase 3 clinical trials results, namely the weight advantages, it having the ability to reduce hypoglycemia and decreases in the fasting blood glucose level as compared to the insulin aspart, that is a long-acting insulin formulation. So other type of the drug delivery system study is the implantable drug delivery system. Implants, they are the basically a very small pellets that composed of drug substance only without excipients. They are normally about the 2 to 3 mm in diameter and are prepared in an aseptic manner, which are needed to be sterile. Implants, they are inserted into a superficial plane that beneath the skin of the upper arm by surgical procedure, which they were slowly absorbed for a period of time. Implantable drug delivery system that can be classified into two categories that define the release profile either through passive delivery or the active delivery. Passive delivery system, it controls the drug release via a material properties that constitute the implant. Passive drug release system is the most studied drug delivery system in the implant that can tune the drug release from the reservoir by controlling the rates of diffusion, osmosis or concentration gradient inside the semipermeable membrane. Active implant drug delivery system that controls the drug release using a pump that can be activated by a number of methods, ranges from the simple manual actuation through the physical pressure or through the electrochemically driven mechanism that can vary such delivery rate depending on the which type of drug molecule is to be studied. Since some implantable drug delivery systems that take advantages of micro and nanofabrication technology that create accelerated FDA approval because these type of the technologies, micro and nanofabrication, that provides the release rate about more consistent, it provides the release rate about to a zero order profile, and it gives a very smart drug release as compared to the passive drug release system and the active drug release system through implant channels. So the FDA approved formulation through implantable drug delivery is the Britasert. Britasert is the implant that has been approved by the FDA in 2005 for the treatment of AIDS-related cytomegalovirus retinitis. The Britasert implant, it consists of a ganicyclovir reservoir that is coated in both polyvinyl alcohol as a polymer and ethylene glycol vinyl acetate as a sustained release polymer that has been sutured on the inside wall of the eye. The PVA mediates the release of the drug and the EVA controls the surface area, and the drug can pass through various channels to release the drug profile through electrochemically mechanism. The implant can maintain the controlled release drug drug profile over a period of 5 to 8 months period of time, after which the implant must be removed and replaced in order to continue treatment. Next is the development of the Ratisert. Ratisert consists of fluty colone acetate that approved by the FDA in 2005 for the treatment of chronic non-infectious uveitis following Vitasert as the second generation reservoir-based implant. Ratisert, it provides a reliable drug delivery up to 3 years period of time as compared to 5 to 8 months period of the Vitasert. Ratisert is also very small as compared to Vitasert, which makes implantation and removal less invasive in nature. This novel sustained release product, it addresses the area of the pharmaceutical market where there is truly no competitive alternative to treat the retinitis problem or the various eye infections. These devices, it can control the drug release via a variety of mechanisms, it including but not limited to physical forces, electrochemical methods, magnetic effects, laser induced or the electrothermal means, depending upon the which type of treatment we have to study. What are the future perspective of the implantable drug delivery? That first is the Iluvion is a microfabrication based device that has been developed to deliver fluconazole acetonide, which required a daily dosing and treatment. It provides a less invasive procedure as compared to the Reticept and the Vitasert. This implant is designed up to release profile for 3 years period of time without requiring replacement. So I will learn it delivered a fluconazole acetonide to the patient suffering from diabetic macular edema. Another FDA approved implant is the Uzedrux. Is used to treat various biodegradable medicines and other biosurgical procedures. It used to deliver corticosteroid dexamethasone for the treatment of retinal virus inclusion. Uzedrux is the first and only biodegradable implant that deliver dexamethasone. Sixth type is the antibody drug conjugates. Antibody drug conjugates, they are the target bioconjugate pharmaceuticals that combine the benefits of monoclonal antibody and cytotoxic drug to treat cancer. ADC involves a chemical linker that conjugates the antibody to a drug that can be either be cleavable or non-cleavable. ADC potentially offers a development path for the higher toxic drugs that are otherwise difficult to clinically implement due to its high toxicity related issues. As an example, the ADC Bentismax Vedaton is a basically facilitated the release of a highly toxic monomethyl acetone E in the clinic, which is otherwise challenging due to the high toxicity of MMAE. Here we highlight the development of most recently approved ADC, that is Trastuzumab Emtansine, commercialized by the Roche, which was seen early commercial success. So the development of the Trastuzumab Emtansine, that is called Kadcyla. That Trastuzumab is basically a monoclonal antibody that is approved by the FDA in 2007 for the treatment of certain breast cancer by targeting the HER2 receptors. The main limitation of the Herceptin is the eventually tumor resistance. So the combination of Trastuzumab with the DMM1 inhibitors that can address this issue. So Trastuzumab Emtansine is comprised of a monoclonal antibody, Trastuzumab. Basically is a potent cytotoxic drug, okay, which combines with the Metasine, that is called DM1 inhibitor, and a linker that covalently attached it Trastuzumab and DM1 together via a reactive substance ester molecule. This linker compound is highly stable in nature and it utilizes the active melamide reactive groups on the Trastuzumab surface to bind thiol groups on the DM1 inhibitors. So this conjugation, it releases the drug to a very sustained release type and it releases the drug to an extended period of time. So the main advantage being is delivered is able to combine the two separate established molecules to synergize its effect, and it leads to the increase in therapeutic activity beyond what is offered by the individual components. The ADC directly addresses the clinical limitation of each of the individual composition, namely the lack of long-term efficacy of the antibodies upon the repeated dosing and the lack of clinical utility that afforded the highly potent DM1 drug due to its high toxicity, which typically result from the lack of specific tumor targeting. So the conclusion is that, so based upon the different type of drug delivery studied, Nova drug delivery system has been provided these several advantages, including the local delivery, use of drugs that are otherwise difficult to use, and increased patient compliance. In addition, Nova drug delivery system, it also provides the means of patient extension, okay, which further adds the value of the new drug molecules. A review of the field reveals that several clinical and the commercial success stories, many subfields of drug delivery like transdermal drug delivery, depot injection, and oral drug delivery have commercially been success with an annual sales of around $1 billion. At the same time, it should also be noted that the journey from an idea to a commercially successful drug delivery system is long and difficult, as evident by the new FDA approved products, in spite of strongly early research pipeline. In the future, the R&D of new molecular entities, it may combine advanced delivery technology to make the drug candidates into more therapeutically effectively solutions. I am thankful for your kind attention.